Good evening, everyone. Welcome, welcome, welcome. And I hope you're having a happy day so far. And it's Christmas Eve. What a beautiful time of the year. And as I start off today, I want to acknowledge all of you who are far away from your loved ones, from your whānau, from your mums and dads, brothers and sisters, uncles and aunties that are overseas or far away from you. It is especially a difficult time when we're not around our loved ones. So I want to acknowledge you. And if you are hosting a Christmas party this year and tomorrow morning, and if you know of someone that doesn't have loved ones around them, why don't you invite them over for some nice food, some nice kai? All right. So I want to just start by sharing a little analogy that I think will make sense to all of us. How many of us like to buy things from the internet? I certainly do. There's something called AliExpress. Show of hands, how many of you have ever bought something from AliExpress? It's kind of like you can buy something that you would get on a local shop for about $15 and you can get it for a dollar. Maybe sometimes even a dollar for a pack of three. So recently, about 3 months ago, 3 to 4 months ago, my kids and I jumped online and we were looking for this particular thing that we wanted, and we ordered it, and we're so excited. We're so excited. And we were prepared to wait a little while, because usually it takes a while when you order online from AliExpress. Normally it takes about 3 to 4 weeks, maybe a month and a half. So I can tell you, we weren't waiting that first month, but after about a month, I can tell you, and this was during lockdown in Auckland, during those days, after about a month, we were anticipating the arrival of this package. We would even respond or react to the slightest noise, this noise that sounds like a courier van, you know, the and then the door opens and it goes. Every time we hear something like that from inside the house, all of us, the two boys and I, would run to the window, we'll look out the window and go, is that a package for us? Surely enough, it didn't arrive after a day, after 2 days, after a week, after about 3 months. I got on the email and requested a refund multiple times. And then the person on the other side said, just be patient. It's taking a bit longer because of COVID-19. And finally, after 3 months and 2 days, the package finally arrived. You know that crazy first world problem of waiting for something and waiting so long? Well, today we're going to talk about something that relates to that, but goes so much deeper, about the waiting. And as I begin, I want to say a word of prayer before we jump into the scriptures. And I hope that this word today will bless you and encourage you and inspire you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this season of Christmas, as we come together, as we remember the birth of your Son, Jesus, dear God, as we remember that Jesus came from heaven to earth, that God condescended from heaven to earth to take on a bodily form in the form of a helpless baby that grew up to be a wise young man. And at the age of 30, began to take on the load and the weight of the world and did ministry and reached out to the world from right where he was for 3 years. And then he died, he was buried, and he rose again, thereby creating the greatest victory in history. And we remember the beginning of that history-making movement this season of Christmas, yet again. God, we love you, we honor you, we commit this time into your hands in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. So we've been in this series, a three-part series called In Time. Pastor Alfred, a couple of weeks ago, spoke about the fact that Jesus is the Logos. And last week, Pastor Richard spoke about the fact that Jesus is the Lord. And today I'm going to speak about the fact that Jesus is the light of the world. Now, I want to take us all the way back to the Old Testament, to a book called Isaiah. Isaiah is a prophet in the Old Testament. The Bible commentaries say that he is the son of Amos. It was written in a time, and Isaiah prophesied in a time where four kings of Judah were reigning. Now, just to set the scene with a bit of history, that at the time, the 12 tribes of Israel were separated into two tribes, a northern tribe and a southern tribe. After the time of King Solomon, the nation of Israel was separated into the 10 tribes of the north called Israel, that retained that name, and the southern tribe, two tribes that became the tribe of Judah. And both kingdoms had their various kings that reigned from generations to generations. And so Isaiah prophesied in the southern kingdom of Judah during the reign of the four kings, King Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah. And during that time, the kingdom of Assyria was rising as a global superpower. It was a very tense time in the geopolitical climate globally. And the northern kingdom Israel had just been defeated and taken captive by the Assyrians. But God delivered Judah from the Assyrians during the time of King Hezekiah. And I believe that this deliverance was most likely due to the obedience of King Hezekiah. Now, the prophet Isaiah prophesied this in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 2. It says here, "The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in the land of deep darkness, on them a light has shone." You know, when you go watch a movie like Spider-Man or James Bond, and you go, and it's after like a 3.5 hour movie, and then you walk out after the credits into the blinking lights of the corridor, and then your eyes suddenly go blinded and it adjusts for a fraction of a second. Sometimes it causes a headache. It was that time where it was so dark. Can you imagine that you're walking in darkness and a mighty great light is shone? During that time, it was a very dark time. People were in captivity. People were under just constant threat of the Assyrians. So the people that heard Isaiah back in those days would have thought, "Ah, it's not going to happen. Why would we see a great light? Things are so dire. It's so hopeless here." I mean, I can imagine if I was living at the time, looking around the society at the time, reading the local newspaper back in those days. No newspapers, I don't think. They didn't have the internet back then. I would have not believed this prophet. And Isaiah and many of the Old Testament prophets would talk about this word called Messiah. In the Hebrew, it's called Mashiach. Mashiach actually means just the anointed one. And it would speak of a mighty light, a great Mashiach that will come at some stage to deliver the people out of slavery, out of captivity, out of the constant threat of danger from the superpower at the time. The Greek Septuagint, which is the Greek translation of the Old Testament, has this word Mashiach show up 39 times. So you must understand that the original Old Testament people that lived back in those days were constantly reminded by prophets that one day Mashiach will come. Now the thing is, I learned recently that the Old Testament people had no idea that this Mashiach would be God that became man. They were just hoping for someone that would be the superhero that would save them. They had no concept that Mashiach would take on the form of God becoming man. It's almost like their best and greatest hope and imagination of what a Mashiach would look like, God far superseded that in Jesus Christ. Reading further along in the book of Isaiah, chapter 9, verse 6 to 7, you see this all the time in Christmas songs and Christmas greeting cards. I wrote this verse so many times when I was writing my stack of Christmas cards recently. It's Isaiah, chapter 9, verse 6 to 7. It says, For unto us a child is born, for unto us a son is given, and the government shall be on his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace, there will be no end. On the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. You see, Isaiah was written approximately 800 years prior to the arrival of Jesus. And we know through scholars and commentaries that the Old Testament, the last book of the Old Testament, was written 400 years before Jesus arrived. So there was a period called the intertestamental period where it seems like God went silent for 400 years. But think about this. Isaiah wrote his prophecies about a coming Mashiach, a coming Savior, an everlasting God, over 800 years ago. You know, I was talking about waiting 3 months for AliExpress to bring my package. This was generations of waiting. Great, 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 great grandfathers passing on orally the tradition to their descendants, saying that one day, this Mashiach will come and deliver us out of darkness. After a dark period of waiting, the light finally appears. It appears out of the darkness. And in John chapter 1, verse 4, it says, "In him was life, and the life was the light of man. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it." You see, darkness is merely the absence of light. And if you have a dark room, the tiniest light, the tiniest flame will light up the entire room. Light has the power to absolutely destroy darkness. You see, the light has come. John chapter 1, verse 9, reading on, it says, "The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God." My friends, if you receive Jesus, you have the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. You see, for us that live in today's generation, we have received the light once. As we look through history, history has proven that Jesus, the Mashiach, has come. He was not only an anointed one in human form, he far superseded people's expectations. He was God incarnate. God himself took on the form of humanity so that he can relate to us, so that he can take on the sins of the world and die and rise again, thereby delivering victory and light that will destroy the darkness. You and I have received the light. But some of these people of the old never received it. In Hebrews chapter 11, the hall of faith, they call it, says this. It speaks of these Old Testament heroes. It says, "What more shall I say? For time would fail me to tell of Gideon, of Barak, of Samson, of Jephthah, of David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, enforced justice, obtained promises. They stopped the mouths of lions, they quenched the power of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, were made strong out of weakness, became mighty in war, put foreign armies to flight. Women received back their dead by resurrection. Some were tortured, refusing to accept release so that they might rise again to a better life. Others suffered mocking and flogging and even chains and imprisonment. They were stoned. They were sawn in two." Ouch. "They were killed with the sword. They went about in skins of sheep and goats, destitute, afflicted, mistreated, of whom the world was not worthy, wandering about in deserts and mountains and in dens and caves of the earth. And all these, though commanded through their faith or commended through their faith, they did not receive what was promised. Get this. These people that were tortured, they were sawn in half. They were persecuted. They never received a promise. But you and I, we have received the promise. Since God had provided something better for us, that apart from us, they should not be made perfect. My friends, what a privilege we have living in a society where we can look back on history and know that the King of the earth, King of the world, the King of Kings has come. So how does light work when we think about Jesus as the light? You see, light pierces the darkness. You know, you could choose to wear shades to block it out. You could choose to close your eyes. You could choose to ignore it. But the light, nevertheless, would pierce through everything that you try to do. As soon as you open your eyes, the light is there. Matthew chapter 5 verse 16 says this, and I love what it says. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to the Father who is in heaven. It says, let your light shine. So do we have light? Can I suggest to you that this light that we shine doesn't come from us? We operate merely, my friends, just like the moon or a mirror, where the moon does not produce light, but it merely reflects the sun. That the mirror reflects light. When there's no light around you, you can't see anything from the mirror. So when we reflect God, when we allow the light of the world to shine upon our lives, the effort and the energy does not come from us. But what does come from us is the ability and the willingness to, number one, to receive this light. You know, you might ask me, how do I receive the light? We need to repent. We need to acknowledge that we live in darkness. We need to acknowledge that there is darkness in our life. And then once we repent and acknowledge that we are in darkness, then after the light shines upon us, we need to reflect. That when God speaks to us and asks us to be kind to our neighbor, to be extra patient with the person that really takes too long or annoys us, or someone that never shows us concern, that we show concern to them, that is how we reflect God's love, because we've received His love, because we understand how dark we are in our human nature of sin, that we don't deserve the King of the world dying for us, but yet He did. So the understanding of that helps us to then reflect God's love to others. And finally, for us to appropriate this light of the world, is to reconcile. God gave us the ministry of reconciliation to call us as Christians, if you're a Christian today, to reconcile the world to Him. So, as I come to land this plane, I want to bring us back to Isaiah chapter 9, verse 2. It says this, the people who walked in darkness, they have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in the land of deep darkness, on them has light shone. As you and I reflect on the news today, as we look around the world, as we think about COVID-19 and the new variant and the variants that will come, as we think about the cancel culture we live in, as we think about the amount of racial tension around the world, as we think about the challenges of diseases and health issues that plague us, as we think about everything we try to do in our human efforts, We do live in a dark time. But I want to go further back in the Bible to the book of Genesis, chapter 1, verse 2, where it says this: "The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the earth. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters, and God said, let there be light. And there was light." I believe this is prophetic. I believe, friends, that this is prophetic. That would I prophesy Genesis chapter 1, verse 2 and 3 over our lives, over the darkness, over your situation, over your illness, over the city that you live in, over your community, over your workplaces, and say, let there be lights. May the light of the world shine upon this dark place that we live in. You see, history has proven that this world only produces darkness. But the future will be bright only through Jesus, the light of the world. As I end this sermon, I want to wish you a blessed Christmas. But before I do that, I want to pray for two groups of people. Firstly, if you're a Christian today, listening to this, and like me, as you ponder upon the fact that you live in a society, in a generation that knows that Jesus, the light of the world, has already come. And one day he will come again and he will finish the job that all of us that call him Lord and Savior, we will be living for eternity in the new earth with Jesus. But there's a world out there that don't know him. Some of them are your friends. Some of them are your neighbors. Some of them are your family members. And you realize that you need to reflect God's light more in this coming new year. If that's you, I'd love to pray for you that you want to reflect God's light even more in spite of your challenges, in spite of the difficult year that you've had. Why don't you gently put your hand on your chest as I pray for you? Dear God, you see these hands right across the city, right across the world, as people are watching this. At the sound of my voice, I pray, Holy Spirit, would you put your hand on their hands? Would you appropriate the light in their lives? Would you destroy any darkness within them? And that would you help them to reflect your light to their neighborhoods, to their workplaces, to their families? Would you use them, my God? Would you use them to show your love, to speak of the good news, to tell them of your love? In Jesus' name, amen. A second group of people I'd love to pray for. If you're here, you're listening to me, and you're not a Christian, or perhaps one day, long time ago, you walked away from God, or perhaps you walked away from church due to whatever reason, maybe you were hurt. You're not a Christian, but you're listening to me today and you realize that you've allowed darkness to enter into your life again, that your heart has become cold, that it's become as hard as stone, that you need this light to thaw out the coldness in your heart, to bring life back to you. You need to come back to Jesus. If that is you, I'd love to pray for you right where you are. If that is you, you want to come back to Jesus, you want to come close to God, would you just gently put your hand on your heart? I'd love to pray for you. Father, you see these hands. These beautiful souls are declaring to you with their hands on their heart that they want to come back to you. Lord, I don't know what situations they've been through or what challenges they've been through, but God, you know. Would you heal their heart? Would you draw them back to you? Lord, your word in Romans says that it's the kindness of God that leads people to repentance. Would you lead them to repentance? Would you allow them to open that door ajar to let the light come in yet again? Lord, I commit them into your hands. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, if you prayed that prayer, I'd love for you to reach out to us, to send us a private message, to let us know that that's what you've done so we can get back in touch with you to help guide you, to pray with you, to walk with you, to help you journey towards God. But if you rather not do that, if you know a Christian, why don't you tell your friend who's a Christian that that's what you've done? You've prayed to come back to God, to let the light of the world come back into your life. Would you do that? Woo! End of the year, everybody. You know, I just wanted to wish you all a very Merry Christmas. And I hope that word earlier was a blessing to you as it was to me. And I just want to wish you all a very safe Christmas. Kia kaha, stay strong. Enjoy the sun out there, but don't forget to enjoy the Son of God as well. And so let's go out with a bang. Let's celebrate Christmas with this amazing, amazing Christmas carol. God bless.
Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Prospero año y felicidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Prospero año y felicidad.
I want to wish you a Merry Christmas.
Navidad.